But it's very closed.
San Francisco moved down.
Well, the point you're all making is absolutely correct. There was this amazing thing that happened around the Art Institute with Rothko teaching and still teaching and
yes.
working on,
yeah.
and wonderful people like Hassel, who was actually teaching too, but then a lot of the LS students, and the whole figurative movement with Deben Korn and Nathan Oliveira, and then Elmer Bischoff and David Hart.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but I got to tell this, it's so great. I went up to see Frank Landau with Walter, and he's in Richard Deben Korn's old studio down by the ferry building. We walk in, big, wonderful, beautifully lit place. Walter and I walk in, and we talk to Frank. And I say, one of those three pages, leaning face against the wall. Deben Korn left them, he says. And then he turns around and goes back into the... and Walter looks at me and says, "Don't ask to see them." I went, and I tried not to look at them.
And of course, Deben Korn became incredibly important. When you were from the New York gallery,
from that part of the world, the most important. I mean, you know, I can't think of anybody more important than Dick. Yeah.
And then Todd Aaron lived in Ocean Park.
But also, I would say not only just his overall importance, but his importance to you. And when you opened Blum Hellman, he was the first artist you...
Exactly right. Exactly right. We showed him. Yeah. He wanted a bigger situation, and he wasn't too happy with the gallery, and I said, "Well, let me organize it." And I organized it with Nerdlin, so that we partnered Dick, although he showed at Nerdlin.
And that's when he really took off.
Well,
the thing is, anecdote at that moment in time, when Deben Korn was the best known artist in San Francisco, but San Francisco had no art market at all. And Deben Korn was selling for, I don't know, $1,000, something like that. And Walter said, Deben Korn made $25,000 last year. That's where we're all making money. And I said, "Jesus, that's a lot of money." He says, "What do you mean that's a lot of money?" He said, "You think he's not any better than a third-rate dentist?"
There you go.
This lady went to Branston. Branston, like the gallery.
Branston.
What's
his name?
Branston.
Rita Branston.
John, I sold quite a few things before she opened the gallery, too. John Branston. Now, John Branston's father was M.J.B. Coffin.
That's correct.
Yeah.
And John went into the business, and John, unhappy. And his father said, "Why are you so unhappy?" He said, "Well, the business is yours. You started it. It's a flourishing coffee business, and I've done nothing." His father said, "What do you want to do?" He said, "Well, a lot of kids are eating granola. I want to go into the granola business." His father said, "Well, go into the granola business. Not a big deal." I said, "What happened, John?" He said, "We went into the granola business." I said, "And then?" He said, "Everybody went into the granola business. We're back in coffee."
But Stanley, one thing that Gemini became really famous for was doing whatever it took to meet an artist's needs.
We had this love affair. We felt we were an artist workshop, so we would present them with, number one, printers who usually have master's degrees or doctorate degrees. A lot of them came to Long Beach, the places that had that, and an openness to say, "What do you want to do?"
Gemini was famous for never saying no.
Yeah, we tried not to. I don't remember ever saying no to anybody because. You had confidence in the people you were dealing with, and anything they did, you knew was going to be worthwhile. So there was that spirit that happened that we all fortunately shared,
But here's a good story, right, about the Oldenburg, the giant ice bag.
Oh yeah.
Maurice Tuchman has put together this enormous art and technology to pair artists with high tech companies.
Yeah, it was a great idea.
Right.
We want to do another one now because technology has changed. Yeah. Well, there are two stories about them. Both of them have to do with claws. One of them is the ice bag, which he put together with Disney. Right. And so he had them out there in closet. He was fascinated by the Disney people. He wanted to meet people who were drawing these animal characters.
Imaginary genitalia.
And he said, what's that about? They're drawing that. So he went out there, and they had a little bit of interchange, but then he proposed this, and they said, it's not for us. I guess they didn't like the corporate image of a nice bag or something. So we said, we'll do it. So we got to the people who were doing a Saturday morning or Sunday morning show. I forget.
The Crofts.
Pardon?
Sid and Marty Croft.
Croft. Well, you did your research. And so we hired them to build it. So then the art technology changed because all of a sudden the Osaka World's Fair was happening in, I think, 68 or 70, and they needed a product, and so it went over there. So then in Disney, he went out to Disneyland Claus, and they showed him the Lincoln that they spent like $1 million for with all the plastic at night, so it wouldn't drift. They would hydraulically lower it down and have it sweeping so it wouldn't be standing up. So, but in the room, because they had a big investment, and Claus goes in there, because Claus always, he would respond to everything. So he sees that it says, if the case of fire, you've got like 30 seconds to leave the room, maybe a minute, because we're going to fill it with chemical and put out the fire.
Right.
But on the wall, there's a fire extinguisher. He says, if you don't read the thing, if you grab the fire extinguisher, you turn into the Lincoln. you walk into one of these old-fashioned restaurants and that with the red tufted thing, I think Brentwood Inn here still does that.
Right.
And Claus comes and says, and you take him there, and he says, this looks like the inside of a stomach. So that was Oldenburg. So we got involved in. So the better one, in a sense, is the airflow. So we did the Chrysler airflow with him, and we had a big party with this, and we rented an airflow to put in the front yard. And he was during his picture taking time during that time. He decided he was a cinema person. When he hit Los Angeles, that becomes part of your something. Anyway, so I remember there was this dog next door who was so brilliant, who walked in as shadow, and he ran the neighborhood, and he walked up, and the party was going on, and here's this airflow car, and he walks up to the car, and he pees on him. He was a critic. They're all critics. So we make it, and I'm in the forklift business, and we use polyurethane, and we know one of the things in it is uric acid. And so I had researched that, hey, we're going to buy the polyurethane. We had to be soft, and they had to be light blue, like a ocean thing. Claus was very careful about what he wanted. So, okay, we passed all those colors. And also, by coincidence, Bob Whitman was out here, and the guy who was his father, and I said, there was this connection, I think maybe I mentioned, who lived down the street, the guy that designed the airflow. The guy that designed the Chrysler airflow was down the street, so we got them, introduced them to each other. It was a relative of Bob Whitman's. So we make it, and about a year later, it starts to turn yellow, or 6 months later, and I go back to the, you promised that it wouldn't turn colors, because I knew that that could happen. Well, and we didn't know, you know, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
So we go, well, what the hell are we going to do? So we tracked down another urethane person, and we got to call them all back. Claus loved it. He said, it's like a carbon call back.
That's right.
Recall.
And we were practically destroyed. In fact, multiples at that time slowed down because of that.
Yes.
Not that we didn't want to do it, but it
became. Yeah, because you had started a whole sculpture division at one point.
Well, yeah, we were very interested in it because some of the artists were, and we still play with it occasionally. We've done sculpture pieces with artists still.
We had down at the gallery that car.
You
had it.
You had it?
Yeah.
First phase or second phase?
That's right, two phases.
I don't know, it was green.
Yeah, they were all green. Yeah. You have to stay green.
But what I thought was the great irony about this was that Tuckman had done this huge thing, a new paradigm for art, that artists were going to work with high-tech JPL, RAM.
Great idea.
But the most famous piece, probably that came out of that, was the ice bag, and that was built by Gemini. I mean, you know, it's not.
There wasn't much technology. We're still, we had a dosing room
through.
So much for
3 days to print one.
So much for where he's talking about.
I knew him at the Guggenheim very, very well. He was one of the least technological people I've ever met. But I mean, it just wasn't in him.
That idea of that show was good. Wonderful.
Yeah, the idea was good.
Yeah. And it changed a lot of people's lives, Bob Irwin or Joe. And it might have changed Doug Wheeler's life.
Yeah.
He's still angry.
Yeah, exactly. He's still angry. Ed Wertz.
Ed Wertz changed his life.
Ed Wertz, he just died.
Yeah, he just died.
Are you going to go?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to be, I think, out of tune. We're going in this round of the world.
It's Sunday.
Oh, it's a Sunday.
Everett, let's go back just for a minute, just because I would love to hear it again. You'll probably tell the story tonight, but one of the apocryphal events in Los Angeles at that moment in time was the Nikki Zampal piece. Up on Sunset Boulevard and shooting across the street.
Well, I don't know. I don't remember her shooting across the street.
That's the story.
Oh, it is? Well, I'm glad I didn't know about it because I would have probably been a defendant.
Yeah.
But she just wanted to do her shoot. And since she came there with Stanley, I couldn't really refuse. When she shows up with her boots and her 22, she wants to do one of her shoots.
So explain what that means.
A shoot is her name. You take a whole bunch of children's balloons. All different colors, and you fill them with paint, enamel, and you tie them up, and you get a hammer and some nails, and you tack them to some sort of a fence or billboard, and then you stand about 10 feet away, and you shoot at them.
And they splatter.
And that is the event.
Yeah.
And I said to myself, I guess I have to do that for Tangle, even what the hell. So, I said, okay, we'll do it. But after all, this is the parking lot, you know, behind a nice bunch of stores on Sunset. Let's be a little tidy about it. So anyway, I come back the next day after the opening, the Tango opening, and I go back there, and there's paint all over the place. And I said, how about my tools that I loaned you? I asked them to keep them clean. All my tools were covered in enamel.
Well, you said you missed that opening.
I missed the actual event because I was having my fingers stitched up. I showed up in time for a little dinner everybody had, but not in time for the opening. No, as a matter of fact, I missed the opening tangling, which I had just installed, but I deliberately did not want to see her shoot.
It's
just interesting in terms of how history deals with that old game of gossip. If you just heard the explanation, I'll tell you my story.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, that she appeared with Tingley, obviously, with a 22 rifle, dressed as an aviatrix, a beautiful white uniform.
That's right.
With a white aviator.
Yeah, that's correct.
She set up her things across the wall, but they weren't balloons, but in fact were rubber dolls that had been filled with balloons that were filled with pigment. And so she was shooting this image, like a 4x5 foot image, with regular rubber dolls on. But when she shot, then the blood would come out like it was coming out through the penetrations of the surface. And that she shot across Sunset Boulevard to do it. So that's what.
Oh.
That's what.
You know, I didn't know about that.
Well, then you did. I'm just saying. History gets mixed up.
I don't see that. Knowing how Sunset Boulevard was built then, she couldn't stand across the street because the billboard was on my side. So there is a Nikki de Saint-Fall tale.
This is the shoe.
Oh, that's the shoe.
It would have busted my windows, Henry.
I think it is. Larry Lipton.
Larry Lipton.
And and
but this was supposedly the one. Yeah,
that's it.
That's it.
That's our chair.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this is the one in Los Angeles.
Great research.
Right out the door. Yes. Okay.
You've done great research.
Elise, a little after us, was the representative for the Niagara
Fund. Okay.
Let's take 2 minutes while
Elise was representative for the Niagara Fund.
Oh, yes, okay.
She met Nikki Yerson, solar mayor.
Well, okay, very all right.
Somewhat inflated, and so they were dolls. Totally transparent.
Well, Miami dolls are
under. I didn't know that.
This is a story
about somewhat inflated and absolutely transparent.
When we come back, I'll tell you the Let's Complete the Sunset Boulevard story of Mark DeSuma, the Peace Star.
Do you hear that?
Oh, yeah,
that's an important moment.
Major.
Incredibly
major,
important.
Major.
So, how early? What, 63?
We're doing great.
Well,
are we getting
it was pretty early.
Okay. You left the country early. 34 was even an issue.
Really?
It's really Jewish coming.
It certainly is.
It was March.
Yeah, it's true.
People still have a lot to say, oddly.
Irving Blum and I could talk on this for probably 50 years.
No question.
One of the sad things I think about the previous, the last couple of days I've been rereading your Paul Cummings oral, what you did with Paul. Yeah. And the thing is that he knew absolutely nothing about what was going on the West Coast.
No.
So he couldn't follow up on any questions or.
And we lost threads, I remember.
Yeah.
Where was this?
Did it in New York in 77.
In New York in 77,
close.
And the thing is that he, for instance, he obviously didn't know who Andrew Shea was.
No.
And so, throughout the interview, and they never corrected it, you have to tell them, of course, whatever, it calls him Edward J.
Really?
Every time it appears, it's
Edward J.
It's a great, great grandson of John J. Always wanted to meet one.
Now, please feel free to take anything, but we're going to have lunch in about an hour also.
Okay.
If you want a snack or some juice or some water and coffee. That's a story we can talk about. What's happened with Edward Shea in the last 5 years?
Oh, it's completely astonishing. I mean, he's really, it's virtually the same thing that happened to Demon Gordon, you know. He became international, only Shea more so, if you can imagine.
I mean, there have been five retrospectives in
Venice. Yeah.
It's wonderful, except that, of course, it's always one person, that's maybe something else we can talk about.
Yeah.
One person always emerges from a scene, and everyone else, and it happens again and again. I mean, and then the way art history crystallizes, you know, for most people now, especially art history and all the books, I mean, pop art, New York pop art, is only Andy Warhol.
Yeah.
And no one
New York pop art is Andy Warhol. But I'll tell you something else. That there was a time when I was bringing all these people to LA when there seemed to be a kind of equivalency. There seemed to be an equivalency. We had wonderful people here, you know.
No, but I think that's right. I think that history does a terrible disservice.
Yeah.
I mean,
to that fact.
To that fact. And to the fact, I mean, something like Roy Lichtenstein, I think, is such a major artist, but Warhol, you know, there are 50 books for every...
For every one of Roy's.
Yeah.
You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. Yeah.
Well, it's these kind of confluence of people, the coming together of creative people from different places, melding in some sort of way that creates a kind of trend that has energy that goes on. And that happens, the saying is right that we shouldn't, the word market, you know, market, when you throw the word market on it, then it isn't cultural logical anymore, it's like business.
But the thing is, I think we have to look at it wrong, because it is a business.
It is a business.
But it does,
It is a business, it is a form of commerce, but when you put the word market on it, it just sounds like make, sell, sell. But it's a little wider than that. There's a whole cultural impact on it.
Absolutely.
That goes well beyond impacting the people who sell or buy. Which goes well beyond the transactional. It changes the energy and voice of the society and what it does and its values, and a lot of things change.
Oh, I think I think the art world here has an amazing influence because it was a real counterbalance to Hollywood. And
let me tell you an experience I had yesterday. I took a shuttle and I said, how many people before we get dropped out of the hotel? It's rarely more than four. So I got in the vehicle and finally, I was the first one in, and there were six more. And then finally at the end, they grabbed another guy and got a seventh in. And they were all over the place. And I was the last one dropped off. Mm-hmm. So I had this great tour of Venice and all these communities.
That you haven't seen in a long time.
And I looked at them and I said, where did all this come from? Well, part of the vision, part of the color scheme, part of the frolicsomeness of the landscape and all this part of the city comes probably from there. And I said, this is very interesting. I mean, I should have paid them $150 for the drive because it was eye-opening, but there was an impact on a society. It's the zooming-ness, but it's part, a part of what's here.
Well, a real piece of history. Next week, Alexis Smith is going to be evicted from her studio in Venice. I mean, financially she's fine. She's
evicted?
But anyways, it's just about the last artist that I know. I mean, there were so many artists who had their studios in Venice. They're all gone, as you know. Everybody, whether it was Irwin, Terrell,
they're all gone.
They're all gone from Venice.
It's suburban.
It's a rich enclave.
Okay. And you come back tomorrow morning.
What would you got? What would you guys like to do?
We're on the audience
tonight. You certainly can.
I didn't bring my metal soldier to play the drums on.
No, but I brought my gun. We're gonna have a shoot.
Why don't we keep going to 1:15 then, and then Patty will take the cab and we'll break for lunch. Why don't we go to 1:15 then, and then Patty's gonna take the cab and we'll break for lunch.
Okay. Good.
Just keep going to 1:15.
Is that okay?
Sounds good.
Yeah,
that's all right with me.
Okay.
And then we break for the day.
Yes.
Yeah. We'll eat lunch.
Andrew, this is terrific. I didn't think it was going to be as stimulating, and the stories are just so good. This is fabulous. And you're a researcher.
Very good.
Your research is incredible.
Andrew, well, spot on.
Incredible.
So I think what we get to now is we've talked about sort of setting up businesses that I think people are very hard for them to imagine how little infrastructure, how little of, I think Irving called it a support network. I mean, that's a good friend. There was in LA when you guys started.
Yeah.
And I like this one because Henry started to bring up the UCLA building, teaching people. You didn't have collectors. You had to teach people to become collectors.
Well, let me.
Let's talk about that.
Are we in business now? Okay, make a couple of observations and then some reactions, which will be different things.
You have to talk about the collector agency. You and I will, and Walter and Charlie.
I will. The point is that there was not an organized support group. However, as I say, the one interest at that time, amongst dealers as well as amongst the people at UCLA at that time, Jim Demetrian, Shirley, myself, Laura.
Laura Lee Stern.
Exactly. And there was really an interest in the idea that art was something that people should know about. I mentioned the fact that one of the building blocks for the community was put together by University Extension, a man named Friedman, who wrote a book called Looking at Modern Art. Had it written, okay? And they were UCLA art professors who wrote it, but it was the history of modern art from Van Gogh up to, not including, but up to the abstract expressionist. Mm-hmm. And the principle of the class was that any 15 people who wanted to come together could call extension and say, all right, we have 15 people, send somebody out. Okay? And we would go to their home with a projector, with a screen, and we would go from a different house to a different house as they were there. And we taught this basic fundamental course. All of us did. Jim taught it, Shirley taught it, Walter taught it, I taught it. And then at the end of it, because Ferris had begun to function by that time, when we were done doing the course material, we would then add a few slides of Bexton, of Craig Kaufman, of Irwin, of the various other people in the gallery, say you should go see these people. You know, they were always, as they still are, tremendously interested in, all right, how do you collect, who collects, so, you know, different things that were coming up. So that course impacted the Ganses, who built that beautiful American collection, for example. The Wisemans certainly were in
very
the,
much
were in those, with those classes. You were in those classes. There were a lot of people that were in them. Then I also, from 1960 until 1968, taught in University Extension every Monday night, basic art history, and then occasionally American art history, and occasionally Los Angeles art history. Hundreds of people came every time. I was always amazed that you would have a class of 100 people that would be sitting there. And so those elements mixed with the Los Angeles Art Walk, which is, Irving said, became a charade. Actually, it was a wonderful parade.
It became painful.
But it brought everybody together about the one word art.
That's right.
Whatever that meant. It
brought
them all. They didn't buy much. They didn't do this or that. But that was terribly important. And then Jim Elliott formed what was called the Contemporary Art Council for the Los Angeles County Museum before it moved to.
When was that?
That was 1962, 63.
Before they moved into the new building.
We were building the new building. We were just trying to generate again education and excitement and what have you. And you know, the Wisemans were members of that. The Grinsteins were members of that. The Betty Asher,
The Gershes,
Holly Hirsch, a goodly number of people who really, for the first time, as we went to their houses for these different meetings, Taft Schreiber, each time you would go, they would have bought something new. That they had David Bright, they had to show off something that they were doing. Okay. Many of them bought in New York, as you said earlier, rather than bought here. But then with these houses, suddenly, that never had any art in them before, suddenly started to burgeon. You know, Dennis Hopper and Brook, Don Factor and Lynn, who were very important to in the evolution of that. But those kind of educational building blocks during that early 60s period, along with the input of people, dealers who wanted to educate and also bring new people in, really to me were the fundamental thing. Then later, Gemini, to a certain extent, Jude Wayne and Tamron too, but especially Gemini, brought these artists from the East Coast to the West Coast, so we integrated in a way that had never happened before.
Tell, as someone who took these courses, what do you remember about them?
Well, it was, our big breakthrough was meeting the artists, really.
Okay.
But the courses themselves were wonderful because it gave you, where people in New York could visit the museum. It was a lot based on the Museum of Modern Art and that approach to what modern art was about, contemporary art even. But it gave you a broader background for what that was. So it gave you more reason to understand a little more, because like anything else you learn, the more you do it, the better your understanding of what your connection is. So I think they were very, very, very important. I think the other things going on at that time, I think Henry hit on the most crucial things, but the Pasadena Museum and the Duchamp show in 63 and the early Bob Rauschenberg and Jasper John show in Los Robles, that was a big issue because those were museum level, where LACMA did it with a council, but L.A. County as a museum wasn't too interested in contemporary
contemporary art. Pasadena in those early days was very interested in. And then a few people came out. For some reason, Clement Meemember didn't come out, but Bud Holland, the guy from, yep, from Chicago. And he used to come out and he'd bring the things he couldn't sell.
That's right.
But he was very good at it. And so that was another thing that everyone went to.
Well, I got back at him. I went to Chicago.
Good.
Good.
But that he was an issue.
But two other things I've got to put in the mix very, very quickly, because I think they were really important. One obviously was Art Forum, and the fact that Art Forum was based here became a national
magazine. A big issue.
Yeah. Big factor, and well edited and put together by Phil Dieter and what have you.
And then John, who gave you a buddy. John Copeland's. Those two are a hot group.
Yeah. It was a hotbed.
And then the other thing, though, that happened very rapidly and was tremendously important is that when the Kennedy Art Council met, as did other groups, they invited artists to come. Literally, you felt like you were part of something, and you actually went there and you sat and you listened.
Yeah.
And we had Clement Greenberg, we had Bill Seitz, we had Rosenberg, we had Barbara Rose, we had Robert Motherwell, we had the amazing,
really good people. Bob Rushmer got thrown out of one of those meetings because it was a Roy Lichtenstein meeting.
He came
to visit it, and his dog was there, and his dog peed in the bedroom.
It wasn't the dog, Bob.
Versus, and she kicked him out.
It was Bob. It wasn't the dog.
He claimed it was the dog.
No bullshit.
And also, watching Joe Johnson swam in the pool in boxer shorts. That didn't make it too.
That wasn't too successful.
People like the Grinsteins opened their homes, and as I say, the art community could count on five hands, but nonetheless, everybody was there. And it was fantastic.
Well, it's interesting. Well, but at this period of time that Henry's explaining, this is where the proselytizing really got going. And that's just. When right after I left, like he was waiting for me to get out of town, then it was going to get going.
Then it took off.
But it kicked in very quickly, and there I was in '63. I was at the Guggenheim then, and then I started hearing all this feedback from my old town. Hey, it isn't so sleepy. It's coming to life, and this and that. So staying in New York, people would come to me. As I was the West Coast expert on what's really going on at the West Coast. So it all worked very, very well. See, when all this was happening with these groups and there was an outreach organized and logical, then this city became noticed more. Mm-hmm. And instead of us dragging them here, there was a healthy interest. And then things started going.
Well, two things. Again, one more building block, which I think, because and tremendously important, is when Maurice came here from the Guggenheim to work, he began immediately by doing a Ron Kitai show. Yes. He did an abstract expressionist exhibition. He did
New York
the culture of the 60s.
Yes. New York and school.
Exactly.
Art and technology.
And the interesting aspect of that, the important aspect of that, is that Los Angeles County Museum and Los Angeles, with the rare exception of Walter doing Duchamp and what have you, were originating exhibitions. And they were originating exhibitions which then traveled to other museums and appeared in Time magazine.
Maurice was not allowed to do those kind of things at the Guggenheim.
No, I don't. Well,
he was quite frustrated when he left.
Yeah, no question.
Because they were terribly conservative at that point.
Well, he was frustrated to hear later on, too.
But this is something that Harry just brought up, that no one today would believe, which is that LA County, especially throughout most of the 60s, did not organize exhibitions.
Right.
No museum in Los Angeles.
No museum in the West Coast. The West Coast did.
Send the budget.
That was our job.
It was like the Ferris Ellen.
You think of it as being the center of what museums do
culture
now.
Well, there were a few shows. I don't know, there was the 60s, I guess. And Billy Allen's show was probably in the 70s.
Art Forum coming
to that was
one of the things. A very big issue.
And
really, major
advertised extensively in Art Forum. Spent a lot of money with Art Forum when it came because it was so important.
Well, let's talk about it. If there is
prior to Art Forum, there was one critic here in town who wrote for the LA Times by the name of Henry Seldes. And Henry Seldes was just a dreadful man. And remains a dreadful man to this day.
Bill Wilson, he's coming in
at the moment. Walter and I had a cabal. We met in 1959, and we said, Henry Seldes, that was the issue, that was what we were going to talk about. Hated every show, Ferris Gallery, ever existed. Hated every show.
And I said, the artist's names wrong.
He got the artist's names wrong. And I said to Walter, we have to do something about this. And Walter said, what? And
contract.
I said,
they got a contract.
Give him something that he can't criticize, that he's got to really enjoy seeing. And Walter said, well, how do we do that, you know? Do you have anybody in mind? I said, yeah, I've got somebody in mind. And I said, I think we should pursue this. And he said, who? And I said, Morandi.
Wow.
And so I went to the World House Galleries in New York. I wrote to Morandi. I put this astonishing show together of paintings, drawings, watercolors, etchings by Giorgio Morandi. And Henry Seldes hated it. And I said to Walter, it's over.
You got one good review on him. It took David Smith to get a decent review.
Well, David Smith by then was too big a, too important an artist for him to criticize.
Yeah, because if one piece would fall over, it would kill
him. It would kill him, yeah. And David would have done that.
What about Jules Langsner? Did he?
Who?
Jules Langsner was much better.
Yeah, much better. Much better.
He was his wife was an artist.
But then Jules and
he was capable of a good
review. Jerry Norland.
Jerry Norland wrote for Frontier. Yeah. Jules wrote for Art News and various other
things. Keynotes called him Jerry Noglad.
I would pick up on the Morandi though, because Roger does, for instance, Bob Irwin. He thinks that Morandi show was so incredibly important for
the artists adored it. They came in again and again and again, and Irwin was particularly moved by it. He couldn't believe it.
And what's interesting about that, and you did this with a few things, I think, at Ferris and some of the others of you, artists who were not in the New York pantheon, Morandi, Klein, who then became extremely influential to the artists out here, a very different...
Well, we had a couple of Cornell shows.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that had to do with the relationship that I had with Joseph earlier on.
Stanley?
In Candy. I want to go on record to something because it goes back to what you said about those about the artists and about those lectures. Mm-hmm. And one of those lectures early on, and it's something unfortunately is still too true today, they talked about the early New York artists and Cedar Barr, and they didn't think anyone could ever sell anything or make a living with it. And then the 40s hit and into the 50s, and they started to make money, and all of a sudden, there was this big scene going on, and it was astounding to them. And so one of the critics of one of those lectures said, finally we gave this art world party that everyone in the art world was there, this art world. He said, every museum person, every critic, every dealer, every collector, said, I looked around, there were no artists there. So one of the things that happens, this destructive, just a little bit of an editorial comment, that we build up this big world that has to do with our money, usually prestige, who shows what at their home, who shows what at museums, and so often the artist is left out of it. It's just left out. And so you build up an art world, and you forget it only exists.
Who's responsible for it?
I think in L.A., but I think the important thing in L.A. at that time, your house especially, Dennis's on occasion, the factors certainly on occasion, the artists were always there. And that was the thing that I always liked so much, was the fact that Betty Asher, you don't ever get a Betty Asher.
Yeah, all of those. But all of the parties that Betty Asher gave at her house, where she combined whatever artists were visiting from New York, because you were having a show, and she would introduce them to all the artists from here.
Correct.
So they socialized.
Yeah.
And they got to know each other,
you know,
that way.
I left too soon. If I had stayed another year, I would have
been
true.
Well, I can miss some good parties.
You know, don't worry. We didn't have that. We didn't come together. It was every man for himself.
Yeah. Do you remember? Let's go back to the Monday Night Oracles, which is something that people remember. One of these people remember most about. Was that going on in while you were here?
Never. But he wasn't on Lafayette, I guess.
But the Monday Night Oracles. The gallery staying open on Monday night.
I don't think that was happening while I was here.
They called it at the height. They ultimately had to close the street.
60-61.
It's interesting about Monday night. I feel a lot like Irving. And I don't want to sound like an elitist.
So that's why.
But it reminds me when I go to Bergamont a lot of the people that have nothing
there
else to do and wander on the openings.
Yeah.
That I think it does open it up to a lot more people and maybe. There's an end result, but I didn't like them.
How did they start? Obviously, it was a way to try to increase the size of the art community.
They started with several of the